Hi, welcome to everyone's favourite segment, Mailbag. Let's get straight into it. Got one from Australia. Beauty, this one is from Malcolm. Good on you, Mal. Thank you very much. No last name, just Malcolm. Let's go. Sorry about the lack of videos recently. I've been busy with various stuff, which you'll see soon. Whoa, what do we got? We've got NBN. NBN, the National Broadband Network here in Australia, which is a complete turkey because our government completely and utterly screwed it up. They spent like $30, $40 billion or something on our National Broadband Network. What it is you know, the huge master plan to make Australia, you know, a super-duper technology country with all this, you know, everyone gets... it was supposed to be fiber to the home, and then the dickhead Abbott government got in that it was fiber to the node, and then copper and wireless and all sorts of bullshit like that. Anyway, it was a complete schmozzle. Anyway, no business park here in Sydney actually has the NBN, yet here just across the road, brand new houses have the NBN. Like, crazy. Like, business doesn't matter. Anyway, found a bunch of these out in the shed and have absolutely no use for them. All right, thanks, Mal. So yes, we have an property of NBN Co. Limited. It's fiber. There it is. Wow. Okay. So that's an NBN fiber modem. Cool. We'll crack that open. It'll be just like a normal modem set, but it'll have a fiber interface on it. And this is a NBN. What is it? UPS. It's some sort of... There's no battery in it. But cool. Okay. It's some sort of backup power gen. Awesome. 2 minute tear down. So these are actually consumer level stuff, as it turns out. This is if you get fibre to the premises, which they're not doing much of here in Australia. Unbelievable. Anyway, I don't know. This is the i240G slash R modem. I don't know if it's actually Alcatel-Lucent. Don't know if it's just like a rebadge, another one, or whether or not they actually had it specifically done for them. Anyway, fibre in, power supply connection, and your Ethernet, and also two phone outlets as well. So there you go. And this is an optional battery backup thing. There we go. There's no battery in there. That's why it's light as. And you can actually, once again, this is consumer level. Well, they have guides for it anyway, available on their website. And that's just a battery backup, so your phone can still work if your local power goes out. Anyway, let's crack it open. And we're in like Flynn, and this is exactly what you'd expect. One big massive ASIC controlling everything. We've got our fiber optic, which is just a connector. It's not a PCB mount. That's going over to here. Interestingly, they've got some sponge on top of that. I don't think that would be thermally conductive, because like there's no reason to do it. Yeah, I don't really get that. There's no, you know, nothing to dissipate it to. So, yeah, go figure. Anyway, got our requisite Ethernet isolation transformers, and not a huge amount more. There's some telephone interface stuff with some protection. There's a poly switch down there. And Bob's your uncle. Not a huge amount more. And the power supply here, just regular mains input. Then we've just got some sort of Phoenix contact connector there, and Bob's your uncle. Classic single-sided power supply, nothing special there, just yeah, it's not even FR4 grade material, very common. Ooh, high pin pitch dip in a socket there, interesting. Anyway, opto isolation over to the main Phoenix contact connectors there, bridge rectifier, main cap, it's all happening. So you've seen that all before. Got double-sided load on the bottom, of course. That's all wave soldered, so they'd all be stuck down. And, well, that's a reasonable implementation. It's got all the requisite protections and everything else. You know, they wouldn't be skimping on this baby, and I don't think they have. They've actually gone to the trouble to embed a thermistor underneath the battery there, measuring the battery temperature. Nice touch. Postcard time. Thank you very much, John McGruen. Got another one from Australia. This one is from a company I know, 4D Systems. You may have heard of them. They're just here in Sydney, out west, and they design and manufacture LCD modules and stuff like that. So hi to Attila, who's the founder and CEO. So let's have a look. They've sent, whoa, goodies. Oh, wow, look at this. Gen 4 series LCDs. Apparently they bought, they're so big now, they actually bought their own LCD company in China or Taiwan or somewhere like that. So they're going great guns, but these things are still designed and manufactured here in Sydney. Awesome, bit of swag, 4D systems. You know, hobbyists do use them, but they're quite pricey. But they've got performance, all the graphics stuff is all built in, and everything incredibly easy to use. And trust me, when I was developing production test systems and other types of systems where we'd build one or 10 of them or something like that, you wouldn't dick around rolling your own stuff. You would. It didn't matter that these cost how much these types of modules actually cost. It saves you so much development time and effort and grief and all sorts of stuff that, you know, they were an absolute bargain. So anyway, very cool. They've got new Gen 4 stuff. Let's check them out.
4D Systems, turning technology into art. Ooh, they got themselves a new slogan. I don't remember that one. Anyway, we've got the Gen 4, Generation 4 Micro LCD 24DT. Micro LCD, guess I can't make anything called Micro LCD. Ah, well. Anyway, and we've got the Micro LCD 43DCT, T for touch, no doubt. And the big daddy, look at this, 7.0. Is that because it's 7 inches diagonal? I think it might be. Wow, look at this. What a Bobby Dazzler. Oh, that's like a mini tablet. Yep, mini 7-inch LCD. Look at that. And they've got nice genuine 3M tape around there to stick it on. So if you're designing your product, you're designing your test system or whatever it is, you just get the cutout like that. And so hang on, 3M. Oh yeah, genuine 3M adhesive smell, love it. And, whoop, that's, oh, there we go. Anyway, they've just taped that on there for you just to keep it in place, stop it going loosey-goosey inside the case. And they've got their 4D Systems chipset. They actually do their own chipset. I don't believe it's a custom ASIC. I think it was a pre-programmed PIC back in the day with all their graphics drivers and everything else in there, because these things are designed to be super duper easy to use. You don't really need to know anything about them, but we've got an SD card on there, and that's a beautiful module. Guess I should read the manual first to figure out how this baby works, but anyway, we've got some user IO there, and that's what, like, there's no, like, power pins on the thing, so presumably you power it through that. Comes with a little Gen 4 interface module. Look at that. That's like a serial RS-232 interface for the thing if you want to drive it old school. Ah, here's a breakdown of the different modules in their lovely quick start guide here. The Diablo processor, that's the one. They've got their own processor and their own language for driving graphics displays and things like that. The 7-incher we've got here, 800 by 480 resolution. And then if you've got the touch version, you've got a capacitive touch, or DT's resistive touch, DCT capacitive touch. Choose your flavor depending on your application. And all the interface types, it can do SPI, serial, I2C, GPIO, it can do analog, so it can actually, because it's a processor, you can actually program it to do its own thing. It can be its own controller. So if you're developing some sort of interactive user display terminal or something, and you want to have it do some basic processing, respond to touches and do all that sort of stuff, you don't need a processor board. You can actually do everything inside this thing. Well, you can try to anyway, and you can even, analog inputs and do stuff like that. Fantastic. Aha, looks like the little serial interface here is designed to hook up to your PC. Why it doesn't have USB interface, I don't know, because that's where you would program the thing from. So that's the only disappointing thing so far. Connect the micro USB cable to the Gen 4 PA. Oh, don't have that one. Only got the serial. Bummer. And then a little 4-inch one here. Oh, isn't it cute? Yes, you do get the same little serial adapter in there, but yeah, isn't that cute? Just put it straight on your product and Bob's your uncle. Fantastic. Presumably, you can use the programming system, the workshop for IDE, and program that and whack it on, whack your code on an SD card and put it in there rather than have to hook it up to the PC. But that is a 100% guess. So I'm going to have to leave playing around with these puppies to a separate video. I don't think it's warranted in the mailbag, but the only thing I'm disappointed about these is power. I would have liked to have seen a couple of screw terminals on there. I don't know what they run from, 5 volts or 3.3 or whatever. I would have liked to have seen a couple of screw terminals on there so you don't have to power it through the flat flex. These are supposed to be self-contained modules, so I really would have like to have seen that, and I don't know why they haven't done that. Looks like you've got to power it through the ribbon cable interface. Actually, these puppies are cheaper than I thought. Maybe they've got the prices down. I remember 4D Systems graphics modules being more expensive than this, although it could be my imagination. The small ones like this start from $29 US bucks, and going up to the 7-inch baby like this, only $129 US dollars. That's an absolute bargain for a completely developed self-contained display system that you can embed into your projects. You know, not great for volume manufacture. If you're making 100,000 widgets, you know, you wouldn't use these, but if you're making tens or even hundreds of units for a client or for some particular purpose, or like especially just for a one-off, if you need a graphical interface, you wouldn't roll your own. It's just not worth it when you can get something like this, which has all the graphics display and processing capability built in, and it can do user I.O. and all sorts of stuff. No contest. Awesome. I'll link them in down below. Thanks, 4D Systems and Attila. All right, let's see if this thing does have anything. I've got it hooked up to my power supply. I don't like the fact that the ground is not the bottom pin down there. It's second from the bottom. No. Anyway, here we go. Let's turn it on and see if it does anything out of the box. Oh, yes, it does. Oh, it's upside down. All the electrons are going to fall out. Please refer to the quick start guide. Anyway, comms, it looks like a 9600 board is the standard interface. Presumably, if we had an SD card in there with the program compiled on there from their visual compiler system software that you can get, then it'd just work, but no. Anyway, powered up. And that draws 2 watts for those playing along at home.
Don't get many letters. This one's from the United States of America, from Rocco Rossetti. Awesome name. Let's have a squiz. Yeah, don't get many letters at all. I'll try not to rip the letter that's in here. I've done that on more than one occasion. Here we go. We have a nice letter. Oh, it's not handwritten or typed. It's printed. Here we go. Closed is a... Enclosed is a USB light. Notice that you could input it. What? Oh, did it like... was it attached to another item? Did it fall out? Anyway. Weird. Email address. I won't tell you, but it involves out of time. Beautiful. He's had it for 15 years. Fantastic. Maybe it fell off or out of something else. Oops. So many things on the shelf there. It's ridiculous. And you know you got too many multimeters when, like, you've just got them under the mailbag items. Go figure. Have you had one from Trinidad and Tobago before? I don't think so. Anyway, from person unknown, we're going to let... Oh, no. There could be a little something in there. Anyway, we've got ourselves a letter. Thank you very much, anonymous person. Let's have a squiz. Little pieces of something or other. Simplest and most useful vintage Tektronics repair accessory. Ooh, vintage tech repair. For all you vintage tech repair Fanboys, let's take a squiz.
I absolutely love products like this. Purpose-designed thing, and it's popular on eBay. Sold 40 in under 24 hours on eBay. It's for the old Tech 500 series plugins with a busted pull tab. So they're made of Lexan, and there you go. It's designed for if you're a Tech fanboy, you got the old Tech 500 series and you've blown these things, eBay item, check it down below. Awesome. Made in Trinidad. Brian Lara country. For you cricket fans, you Yanks probably have no idea who Brian Lara is or what cricket is. Goodness. Anyway, awesome, Ansel. That is perfect. Niche product. Great stuff.
Made in Canada. Hi to all my Canadian viewers. Beauty. This one's from EpiFan, if I'm pronouncing that correctly, EpiFan Systems Inc. in Canada. And this one is quite interested in this one because it's a tool which I can most certainly use here in the lab, I suspect. Hate it when they've got the invoices on the outside because you've got to tear through like 10 sheets of paper. And yeah, so this is for people like me and maybe some of my audience as well. Ta-da! The simplest way to share video. It's the AVO, EpiFan AVO. Anyway, it's a 4K video capture device. Awesome. Let's check it out.
So here we have the Made in Canada AVO, I think it is. Yeah, 4K video capture, HDMI in, USB out. Of course, it has to be USB 3, and yep, you get a USB 3 connector in there, and it allows you to capture, stream, record, no software to install. All you do is connect the cables. Fantastic, up to 4K. I'm hoping that, I haven't checked the actual specs of this thing, but hoping that, I don't shoot in 4K here, but I might in the future, who knows. But I do have my Tagano microscope, which is a pain in the ass to capture from. At the moment, I'm using a AVA Media. Yes, hang on, I'll get it. There it is. I'm using the AVA Media Live Gamer Portable, which will capture, which will input 60 frames per second, and it saves it. I just save it to the SD card. I can go to the PC and stream as well, but I do all my capture from that, and then I just have my, and I have an external mic coming in here, which I record from at the same time, and this works reasonably well. It's a bit buggy. Sometimes it doesn't record properly. Anyway, this will only record, it'll input at, it'll accept 60 frames per second at full HD, but it won't record. So it only records at 30 frames per second, but at least it works. Maybe this one, with its big beefy processor and everything else, will actually sample and at 60 frames per second. Same shame, it's not SD card savable. It's, you've got to stream it to the USB. Yeah, but it's designed for streaming applications, live video, all that sort of jazz. Don't turn it on. Take it apart. And it is a nice bit of kit, let me tell you. Feels super high quality, made in Canada. Thank you very much. And yeah, there you go. HDMI in. It got some vents in there. We can see some big. It's actually hefty. It looks like we've got some decent size heat sinking in there. And you can see it through that. Or is that just the end of the can? Anyway, I've taken the screws off. Might have to pry it open. Here we go, we want the reveal. Ta-da! Oh, look at that! Little low-profile fan inside that thing. Isn't that sexy as? No wonder they had the vents in there. Oh, what's that? Oh, that's a little light pipe. It's a little light pipe on there, but yeah, there. That is beautiful. Heat sinking, I'm not sure. Yeah, I can get the heat sink off. Hang on. You can see on the base of the board here, before I take the heatsink off, we've clearly got three BGA parts. One here, that looks like a, for all the world, like an FPGA pinout, wouldn't surprise me. And then they've probably got, you know, like an ARM interface, ARM micro or something like that. Who knows? Anyway, let's flip it open. Oh, I don't know where the cable for that fan's going. But let's, oh yeah, got a bit of paste. Oh, there we go. Ah, we're good. We're being slimed. And here you go, this makes complete sense now. Yep, it was an FPGA, but it's upside down. Yes, all the electrons will fall out. No surprises for finding a Xilinx RTX 7 here. Real high-end FPGA. Big grunty beast. I didn't get the exact model number there. Anyway, you can look it up, and it's probably like $100 in like one-off quantity. It's, you know, doing a lot of horsepower inside this puppy, and they haven't decided to roll their own 4K HDMI interface. Why would you? Analog devices do a whole range of HDMI interfaces. I've used the Analog Devices HDMI interface chips before, but when I did it, geez, 4K wasn't even invented then. That's the ADV7619, and that is an absolute beast as well. It's got a 36 to 48 bit output bus for all the component video. That'd be funnel straight over. Look, you can see the termination resistors there. There you go. And that'd be funneling all that data through to the RTX, which would be doing all of the processing, all the heavy lifting of that thing. And then the USB interface, yeah, you're not going to roll your own USB 3. Hey, Cypress Semiconductor do that as well with the CYUSB314 for those playing along at home. But yeah, that's what you're paying for, all the magic inside there. But then again, from memory, the Analog Devices HDMI chips I used to use, they were like $50 parts or something. They weren't cheap. I'm not sure what this one is, actually. I'll have to look it up, and I'll annotate the video. Anyway, that's a very nice board, and I like the fact that they left the solder mask off there and gold-plated that, gold-flashed it, because that connects through to the case down in there, and that makes a half reasonable RFI shield connection to the case. Anyway, no wackers. So that is a nicely engineered bit of kit, and they claim it's tough as nails, and yes, it is. I love the case it in. It feels absolutely robust. You could stand on that thing, you could drive over that thing in a car, and no worries whatsoever. It's gonna survive. It costs $399, which sounds like a lot, but for a professional 4K USB streamer like this, then yeah, it's value for money. Anyway, the proof is in the pudding in terms of actually streaming video. Make sure there's no bugs in the thing. It does it reliably, all that sort of jazz. So obviously I can't do that in the mailbag. I'll have to leave that for a separate video, but I'll definitely try it out on my Tegano microscope. And I just checked the specs, and yes, it does do 1080p at 60 frames per second streamed. So beauty. I've got the perfect test platform for that. And by the way, these end pieces look like plastic, but they ain't. I got one from Elector in Germany. You know Elector, they've had like, this is probably their fourth Suck of the Sav, is it? Anyway, some people have asked, like, what does Suck of the Sav mean? It's an Australian expression. I'll let you research it for yourself. Anyway, yeah, common expression here in Australia. Fair Suck of the Sav, mate. Anyway, what have Elector sent? Oh, Elector magazine, okay, excellent. Haven't read Elector for donkey's years. Yep, used to be. Oh, we've got a ruler. It's not as good as the Elector Labs ruler. Not as good as the micro ruler. Sorry, I have to get back and actually release the micro ruler too. That I've that some people have got, but yeah, I've been slack. Anyway, Eurocircuits.com. Anyway, it's got some gauges and stuff on there. It's got more paperwork than items. It's got a bunch of stuff, which I like. There we go. Alright, what do we got in here? Oh, it's the Elector Uno Arduino. And this comes from Jan, the editor-in-chief of Elector magazine, and they're spruiking. They are fans of the blog, by the way. Thank you very much. And they've sent through not only the new Elector Labs Arduino compatible clone. Here you go. Let them explain it. There are a zillion Arduino things out there, but this one's special. The Elector Uno R4 is an evolution of the Uno R3, uses a blah blah blah, supercharged B brother, blah blah blah. This puppy has two USARTs, awesome. 4 SPI, 2 I2C, 5 timers, a whopping 9 PWM channels, plus an extra 4 GPIO ports. Sweet. Can also run off 3.3, so it's goodbye to the level shifters. Awesome. There you go. So apparently it's an Uno R3 on steroids. There it is, the Electrolab. It's, yeah, an Arduino-looking thing. Check it out if you want it. Oh, there's the barcode. There you go. Scan it. And for you ruler aficionados, here's the Elector Labs ruler. Oh, it's upside down. Inches and millimeters. 1.6 millimeters standard. It's got hole gauges. It's got trace gauges. But yeah, sorry. I still like my micro ruler better. This is my micro ruler. Oh, a 3. Geez, am I up to revision 3? There you go. Anyway, I have to get this one. Some people have them, but yeah, I've got to get them back into mass manufacturer again. Anyway, my one's got a flux capacitor. Can't be beat. And it's good to see that Elector magazine is still going. Look, it's chock-a-block with all sorts of stuff. $26, I haven't bought this for many years. It wasn't available, easily available in Australia for a long, long time. But anyway, there's Jan. Thank you very much for sending this in, and there's a whole bunch of stuff. Look at these tips and tricks. Oh, analog meter. Gotta love it. There's Arduino stuff. Uno. No doubt there's going to be lots of micro and stuff like that. Circuit maker tips and tricks. There you go. Ooh, we've got some Internet of Things. Anyway, there's a whole assembler crash course. Good old through hole. It's actually, this looks really good. They've got a lot of stuff in here. I like it. Haven't looked through Elector for a long time, but there's the the old Philips meter. There you go. You can still pick those up for a song on eBay. What are they doing? That's neat. Someone put a new display. Fons Jansen from Maxim put a new integrated new display into one of these Philips system multimeters. Neat. Software-defined radio stuff. Oh, it's all in there. Eye pendulum. Oh, geez, there's all sorts of cool stuff in here. Bat detector, if you're into your bats. Why wouldn't you be? Awesome. There's the Uno, which they had, and brick power supply. Terrific. So there you go. Magazines are still going. And when I was a boy... Oh. Hexadoco, there you go, if you're into that sort of thing. Anyway, when I was a boy, before we had the internet, the magazine was it. This is where you got all your information, apart from, data sheets and app notes and things like that, which you had to get in physical form. You couldn't download them. There were no websites back then. And this is, you know, where the hobby revolved around was the magazines. And it's good to see them still going. It's getting very difficult to compete with the interwebs these days, but good on them. Support them. I'll link it in down below if you want to get Elector. Don't know how much it is. Doesn't say.
One from Germany again. I'm not sure if this is a name or not. Volker Off. O-T-H. I'm not sure if that's a name or not. Sorry. Interesting. What's inside this one? Let's check it out. Sometimes I know because there's a description. Yes, Volker, forum nickname. Oh, yes, Dead Beef. Yes, on the forum, 0x, hex, Dead Beef. On the forum, yes, the EV blog forum, that is. Oh, isn't that cute? Wow, IRDA USB interface. Let's check it out. Oh, for multimeters. Awesome. Hey, I like that. Love that case. This is jazzy.
So Volker here has come up with this little infrared interface for Gossen Metrohit multimeters, because Gossen are famous for their real expensive infrared interface. Now, I was going to extol the virtues of this, but I just plugged it in and I tried to pull it back out of my Metrohit energy here, and oops, it broke off from there. Yeah, I think something needs to be done with the robustness there, but... Look, there we go. It's a bit brittle, but something... come on, come out of there. But look, I think maybe there's something wrong with my plastic. See how it curves in like that? So I don't know what the hell's going on there, but Yeah, anyway, it was a real tight fit in there, so I tried to just pull it directly back out, and it was wedged in there too far, and it broke. Oh, but it'll still work, because there's a little infrared receiver, or transceiver in there, and serial interface, and some dip switches to set various stuff, whatever that is. And Volker has reverse engineered Gossen's one, and this is open source hardware available, and you know, Creative Commons, all that sort of stuff. I'll link it in down below. Much, much cheaper than the Gossen one. Oh. My other Gossen meter, it's the same. It's got that curved in, so what part it was supposed to go into, I tried to shove it into the center there, and oops.
Next up, one from Chris Hopkins from Sukasuna in New Jersey, in the United States of America. We have a, well, I won't tell you, because it'll just spoil it. Hang on, I thought it might have had one of those pull things. Yep, there we go. Ta-da! Oh, and bubble wrap for our protection. We've got a note. Let's see. Ah, and static shielding for our protection. What is this? Oh, Sony Vaio Motion Eye. What? Bluetooth wireless LAN. What the hell is it? It's one of the, you probably, a lot of people might know what that is, but it's a Sony thingamabob, broken screen.
Aha, it's a micro PC. That's why I have not seen this before. I don't recall it at all. It was a handheld pocket computer equipped with an x86 processor. None of this ARM rubbish. Lots of features that ran full version of XP Pro or Vista. Wow, in a little pocket size thing. They didn't sell very well due to the high price. Wow, like $2,000 US. Weak battery life of 2 to 3 hours. The interesting but annoying keyboard and the general pain in the ass using desktop interface on a 4.5-inch screen. This one's dead. Anyway, there's the slidey up keyboard. Look at that. And that is a pretty horrible feeling keyboard too. There's no, tactile response. There kind of is. I guess there's a little tactile dome on the PCB underneath if we did a teardown on it. But it doesn't feel good at all. It is not a good tactile response. It's real squishy and it's just, this was just like... What you know, meeting did this come out of? What design meeting did this come out of? I think everyone walked out thinking, oh yeah, at least we got something out of it. But everyone probably, the engineers probably went back and groaned. We've got to design this thing. It's going to be a complete and utter flop. Windows XP. Obviously, this is more than a 2-minute teardown, so that will be a retro teardown, vintage computer retro teardown coming up soon. Thank you very much, Chris. Awesome. Wait, not only do they have a camera on the front, the Motion Eye, ta-da, they've got one on the back as well. Look at that. They thought of everything in that meeting. Brilliant.
Isaac Porus. Good day. Isaac from Portland, Oregon, and I'm concerned with what this is. Anyway, look, I'm an expert at these United States Postal Service packages now. He's the inventor of the solder doodle. I guess we have a solder doodle. Ooh. It's a USB rechargeable soldering iron. I don't know. I don't get the feel of that. I don't under that. It's supposed to be molded for your hand, but I don't kind of. Maybe, but it just. Oh, okay. And then you've got instant heat. I don't know. I'm afraid of that. It's probably going to do the business if you're desperate and you're in the middle of nowhere and you need, you know, you're on the road and you need a USB. Oh, we've got all sorts of tips. Oh, interesting, all custom tips. And you need a portable, when you need a portable soldering iron, you need one. And there are various ones on the market of various quality and things like that. And they're all, even the good ones are meh, you know, they get you by, but you wouldn't want to do anything serious with it. But it gets you out, it gets you by in a pinch. Oh, nice chisel tip, useless conical. We've got, oh, a little, a fine bent conical. Some people like those. Anyway, let's have a look at the solder doodle.
So there you go. Isaac is the designer of this thing. And thankfully, he says that it's good for 24 gauge wire and higher. Heats up in 15 seconds. Yeah, I wouldn't be recommending this for, you know, like, SMD work or anything like that. It's designed for, you know, rough and ready soldering in the field and stuff like that. Solder doodle, it is open source USB rechargeable soldering iron. There you go. First thing is it rattles. Second, I don't know. I swear this grip just doesn't. So I can see what you've tried to do, you know, like with the shaping of that, and it could be right or left-handed as well. I can see, but I guess, but yeah, something just doesn't feel right. I'm not sure what it is. Anyway, one of the first things I noticed is that there's no guard to stop yourself slipping like that and burning your fingers on the tip of this thing. So that would be my first thing, is it should have had a guard ring on here. Any good soldering iron will have a guard ring. So it's just, I think it's probably too easy to just slip off the end like that. And here's the various tips. I guess they're custom designed. Comes with comes with different types of tips. Anyway, look at that. That's a, yeah, like a, that's looks like a hot knife to cut through stuff. Anyway, what you need is a couple of millimeter chisel. That's what you want. Oh, wow. Is that, that looks for all the world like an RCA connector. I think it is. I think it is. It's an RCA. It does look for all the world like an RCA. Wow. Anyway. I don't know. All right, let's give it a burl. Here we go. I've got to switch it on and then press down the button. What did he say? 15 seconds or something? All right, let's heat it up. And I've got some 60-40 stuff here, none of this lead-free rubbish. And let's see if we can heat up something like this connector here. You probably can't see it, but that's flexing. It's not heating up that pad. Is it? Come on. You can do it. Oh, geez. Oh, this is really struggling to tell you what. It's melting just. But, yeah, there's no thermal capacity in this thing at all. I'm holding that on. How long have I been holding that on? For at least 30 seconds. And there's no... Right, so I can't even heat up a pad on a... Yeah, the solder's melting. Okay. Got our melted solder. But even if I blob it on there to try and get good thermal coupling, it's not heating up. It's not heating up that pad at all. And that's just a... I would have expected that to work. It's just not working, and there's no temperature adjustment on the thing. Nah. So maybe okay if you want to join some wires together, but nah, sorry, Isaac. I think this is just failing. I mean, the light's on. Somebody's home. Nah, it simply can't do this pad, and no, that one's not connected through to the ground plane. It can't do a pad of that size. It can't even do one of the legs of this common mode choke here. It can't do that. The best I'm able to do is like a pin, you know, you can do eventually. Oh. Yeah, it does take about 15 seconds to warm up. You can, oh, sorry, you can't see that, but I can actually do pins on this connector. Okay, so that is possible, but yeah, the thermal capacity is terrible. using a nice big chisel point, I it's just not working. Sorry, it does not have the thermal capacity to heat up one pad and one pin. Nah, got to call that a fail. Sorry, solder doodle, thumbs down. And if we have a look inside, single 18650 cell, excellent. So you've got no issues with multi-cell charging and stuff like that. The little board in there looks quite, looks more than adequate. I'm going to say that's solar cycle. What's that? Anyway, wiring looks a bit wimpy going off to the connector over there. Anyway, you can see how the switch mechanism works. It doesn't do anything there, but where you switch it on, boop, it can come on like that. It's, you know, it's okay. Anyway, no good as a soldering iron, really, unless you're just joining a couple of wires together or something like that. And these are 3D tools, 3D trimming tools, you know, to trim plastic and stuff like that. I'm sure it does work for that sort of purpose. I think I had a little review of a 3D cutting tool a couple of mailbags ago, and similar sort of thing. So yeah, if you're looking for a soldering iron for the field, this one, like for, you know, real electronics use, this one's probably not going to cut the mustard, I'm afraid. More work required in the thermal capacity aspect of it.
Thank you very much, Jason Olszewski from Rochester in New York. Another one from the United States of America. And let's have a look. It's not a complete mailbag without a vintage device, and that's what this one is. Spoiler alert, but I don't know what. It just says vintage. So, we like vintage stuff. Oh, is this... Oh, that's a typewriter. Here we go. No worries. Thank you very much. I typed this on my very awesome wide carriage Royal Express from the 1960s. Aha, street cred. I think I get the impression it was kind of special edition since it has some sciencey add-ons. Oh, plus, minus, and degrees, keys, and... Ooh, anyway. Awesome. Fantastic. Let's have a look. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Haven't had one of these puppies on here before. An Adler 805. Wow, look at that. Germany? No, it's from a German company, but it's made in Japan. All the best stuff's made in Japan. Awesome. Hang on. That's got a distinct mid-1970s smell to it. Am I right? Sweet 1970s vintage circuit board. Adler from 1974. The nose knows.
So here's the Adler 805. Look at this 8-digit display. It's just a 4-banger, basically. And it is huge. You'd expect it. Like, it's big enough to have, like, the tape and the, you know, like, the thermal printing and stuff like that. But then there it is, made in Japan. Only uses 4 watts. No worries. Sniff of an oily rag there. 1970s construction all the way with LBJ. Look at that. What's a tin plate? It's all like hand tape laid out, of course. What's happened to the... Look, they've got, you know, tin plate there, but then they've got sections left out there. It had something on it and they didn't get any tin plate. Good old single-sided construction with the Jumper Links NEC processor for those playing along at home. Couple of discrete trannies down here. And look how they've done the wiring. Look how they've done the connections there in some weird shape. What's going on there? Look at the display. It's got a, like, is that like power of 10 display? There you go. And we've got our nipple, of course, because it's a vacuum fluorescent. But look... That is just classic. Absolutely classic. From, can we get a date code? Sadly, no date codes on that chip at all. Wow. Transistor regulator there, is it? Oh, classic. I'm just like, wow, look at it. Mains tranny over here. Well shielded, no worries there. All right, let's see if this puppy works. I'll turn my 110-volt transformer on. And... Oh, it works! Look at this! Ah, Bobby Dazzler. 2+3=5. And there you go. Winner. What's that doing over there? I'm not entirely sure, but it does kind of work. And the combined minus and equals and plus and equals sign here is a bit disturbing, because that's not, that's just one button. Oh, yeah. Well, you know, I don't know what K is. Constant? Mo? Some constant thing or something? I've got no idea. Anyway, winner, winner, chicken dinner. The Adler 805.
Another vintage device that's had the crap beaten out of it. It's lucky it made it here. It hasn't got a huge amount of padding. But anyway, thank you very much, George or Georgie Chankov. From Bulgaria. Hi to all my Bulgarian viewers. Wow, we don't get many from Bulgaria, so let's check it out. Another vintage thingamabob. Ta-da! 5¼-inch floppy! Woohoo! From it's Bulgarian, 1987. Wow. Okay. Oh, it was made in Bulgaria in 1986. It was supposed to work with the Bulgarian-made Pravets computer. There you go. Hands up if you've heard of the Pravets computer. I'll link it in down below. There is a wiki page for it. I bet you haven't had the chance of tearing apart Bulgarian-made computer parts. No, I don't think we have. Thank you very much, Georgie, for sending that in. 2-minute teardown. Oh, wow. And mid-80s. Everyone was switching to 3.5-inch floppies by then. But not in Bulgaria.
Look at this Bobby Dazzler, would you? 5¼-inch floppies. Who can remember those? Yes. And that, if you can read that. Anyway, 1987. Let's take a look inside. Flathead screws. None of this Phillips rubbish. I'll tell you what, there's a few screws loose in the top paddock here. It that board just slips in there like that, and yeah, I think it's there we go. It's missing a couple of screws. Sure enough, look at this, all through hole, of course. None of this surface mount rubbish. We've got a date code, there we go, 11th week 86, so it's at least mid 86 construction. I just love the little bit of extra heat sinking down there, little bit of aluminium plate on the tranny down there. Fantastic. Oh man, this is just, we've got a couple of trimmers here, and they would be for speed adjustment or something like that. But yeah, there's not much to it. I mean, there's very little there's no like digital processing or anything going on here. It's pretty rudimentary controller, so to speak. Very, was drive reminiscent or something. There's very little electronics in here to actually drive this, so I'm not sure how much was being done on the computer side of things. But I mean, we've basically got our head is going to be down in there, and it's going to come through this little shielded cable here. So this is going to be our head amplifier. We've obviously got our motor driver transistors here. They're going down to the motor down there, the stepper motor. And there's not a huge amount in these things. They are really quite simple in the scheme of things. And well, if we lift that up, there we go. The head is going to be stuck under there somewhere. Yeah, you can just see it right down in there. Geez, I can remember cleaning 5¼-inch floppy heads. You get the cotton bud out, the isopropyl alcohol, and clean away. Beauty. Or you'd use one of those cleaning discs, you know, you'd whack the alcohol on the cleaning pad and shove it in and make it make the drive head seek across, and to clean the head. That was reasonably efficient back in the day, but there you go. Beautiful. Mid-80s. I mean, you know, I would have thought if I opened this up and didn't have any date codes, I would have thought, yeah, maybe this came out of like the late 70s or something like that, but they're still making this in at least mid-86. So So there you go. We've got an extra board down in there and a big 10-turn trimmer. Thank you very much. And yeah, a little heatsink down in there. I don't know what's doing down there.
We're on a roll. Let's do some more. Another one from Australia, from the lovely Blue Mountains, from Person Unknown. Thank you very much. 2-minute tear down something old. That's what it says. All right. Oh, yeah. To go with our 5 1/4-inch floppy, thank you very much. Old school phone. It's a modem, a Sendata modem. That's our 300 board. Oh, yeah, what a Bobby Dazzler. Check that puppy out. 300 board modem. Hands up if you had a 300 board modem. That's what I started with. 300 board. What was the 300? What was the 1275? Oh, I forget. What was the one that had the 75? I get anyway, yet 300 board. That's basically 300 bits per second. And I would connect to local BBSs, local bulletin board systems. And yet this was not none of this auto dial rubbish. You had to dial this yourself. So you'd have answer originate and you'd have phone data switch. So you would dial the number on the phone and then you listen to the, you know, the modem sex sound, and then you'd flick the switch and hopefully connect to your bulletin board, out which was run from people's homes, and they'd have 10 phone lines coming into their house. So, you know, depending on which bulletin board you called up and the generosity of the person running it, with all those phone lines, you would hopefully get a connection. Sometimes you'd have to wait in line and you'd just keep dialing all the time until you get in. And then usually they'd have a time limit and they'd boot you off like after an hour or whatever it is, so that, you know, you don't just hog the thing and stay connected all the time and using up one of the connections. But yeah, old school 300 board modem. Ah, oh, those were the days. Then I upgraded to 1200 board modem, and then I got the Netcom after that. Was it after that was the Netcom Trailblazer? Anyway, I ended up with the Netcom Trailblazer, which was, what was it, 13,000, 14,000 or something board? I can't remember. Anyway, it was the duck's guts, but you had to have somebody else who had a Trailblazer compatible modem on their end to use it. But, beauty. Anyway, 2-minute teardown. Sorry, nostalgia.
Sendata Direct Connect Modem, Electro Medical Engineering Proprietary Limited in Armidale, in Victoria. Wow. Made in Australia, I'm assuming. I think it might have been made here. What a Bobby Dazzler. 300 bits per second, answer and originate. Who can remember answer and originate mode? Oh, who can remember their AT commands? Come on, hands up. Originate, answer, phone, data, that's all you needed. And dial your own number, preferably with an old school rotary dialer, and then flick your modem in and massive 300 board. Oh man, you could see the characters coming up on the display. Brilliant. Who remembers Kermit? Kermie. Oh, check it out. Classic single-sided construction. Look at the big ass AC caps here for our line interface over here. Did this? Yeah, this had telecom approval, didn't it? Yeah, telecom approval number. There you go. It's telecom approved. No worries. And little piddly bridge rectifier there for our mains. DC plug pack input, our serial interface. Bugger all else. Well, you didn't need much, really. We've got a LM324. What are we? Recon R5631. Don't know what that is, but an LM324. And not sure. That's an XR brand. And the ICL7660 charge pump. We've got two charge pumps here to generate the negative rail. And not much else. This line isolation transformer. Oh, goodness. Classic. Made in Australia. And that's late 83, so this would have been manufactured early 84 or thereabouts. Oh, swap your transmit and receive. Hi, welcome to Tear Down Tuesday. We've seen this one before. This was sent into the mailbag segment recently by Chris Bowden from the Geek Group. So I'll link in the Geek Group down below. Thank you very much, Chris. And what it is it's an analog computer for an inertial navigation system, an astro compass system used on the B-52 bomber. So let's check it out. Awesome. And I think she's about to pop. Maybe a few more whacks.